Good afternoon, Bruchim Habayim, and a Gitte Woch to all. My name is Carl Ehrlich, and on behalf of the Israel and Golda Koschitsky Center for Jewish Studies at York University, Canada's first and oldest center devoted to Jewish studies, I would like to welcome all of you to the 2021 iteration of the Leonard Wolinsky Lectures on Jewish Life and Education. The Wolinsky Lectures are a major annual public lecture series meant to forge ties between the world of academia and the broader community. And I'm glad to see so many of you zooming in to join us virtually today. Our overarching theme for this year's Wolinsky Lectures is the lives and afterlives of Yiddish. And we have invited two excellent scholars and engaging lecturers to share their unique perspectives on this subject with us today. They are Professor Sarah Benor of the Hebrew Union College Jewish Institute of Religion in Los Angeles, and Dr. Eddy Portnoy of the YIVO Institute in New York. Following my opening remarks, my colleague David Kaufman will introduce our first speaker, Sarah Benor, at the conclusion of whose lecture we will take a short 5-minute break to allow people to stretch their legs, refill their coffee mugs or teacups, and to take care of any other pressing or urgent business. Following the break, Sarah Horowitz, my immediate predecessor as director of the Koschitsky Center, will introduce our second speaker, Eddy Portnoy, following whose lecture we will take another short break. At the conclusion of this break, Kalman Weiser, the Koschitsky Center's associate director, will moderate a discussion between and a Q&A session with our lecturers, Sarah Benor and Eddy Portnoy. If you wish to ask either or both of our guest speakers any questions, please open the Q&A menu at the bottoms of your screens and type your questions in the space provided. Although I cannot promise that we will be able to pose all questions submitted, we hope to be able to cover as much territory as possible during the 2 hours in total that we have allotted for this program. Before handing over the virtual podium, I would like to offer a few words of thanks to some of the many people who have made today's event possible. First and foremost, to the family of the late Leonard Wolinsky for their generous funding and support of this long-running lecture series that has brought so many of the most illustrious names in Jewish studies to speak at York University over the course of the years. Then, of course, to the lecturers themselves. To Kalman Weiser, our resident Yiddishist, for organizing today's event. To the colleagues who have taken on the duties of introducing the lecturers and moderating the discussion. To the technical staff, without whom we would never have been able to mount such a complex program. And perhaps most important of all, to the Koschitsky Center's coordinator extraordinaire, Julie Feinberg-Telesnik, whose tireless work behind the scenes ensures the success of all our ventures. Finally, I would like to thank all of you for your attendance and to wish you a most enjoyable and edifying afternoon. And now I would like to call upon Professor Kaufman to introduce our first speaker.
Hello, everybody. Thank you, Carl. It is my pleasure, not duty, to introduce my colleague, Professor Sarah Benor, who is a professor of contemporary Jewish studies at Hebrew Union College, the Jewish Institute of Religion in Los Angeles. She's also an adjunct professor at the University of Southern California in its linguistics department. Sarah received her PhD from Stanford in linguistics in 2004, and she's published very widely about Jewish languages, linguistics, Yiddish, American Jews, about Orthodox Jews in particular as well. Her books include Becoming From, How Newcomers Learn the Language and Culture of Orthodox Judaism from 2012, and her newest book, Hebrew Infusion, Language and Community of Language and Community at American Jewish Summer Camps, published last year by Rutgers. Dr. Benor co-edits the journal Jewish Journal of Jewish Languages and directs the HUC Jewish Language Project, which features a very interesting Jewish language website and the Jewish English lexicon. Sarah, we're looking forward to your talk, and I'll happily help coordinate any bits that you have along the way.
Great, thank you so much. I'm really honored to be here today. And I have a soft place in my heart for York University. It seems like a really wonderful place. I'm gonna be sharing my screen to share some images and sounds with you. And the first part of my talk is actually pretty interactive. So I'd like to ask for some audience participation, and David Kaufman is gonna let me know what you say, because I can't actually see it in the chat myself. So I'm gonna start with some characteristic quotes. And I want you to tell me who might say such a quote. What type of person? Here's the first quote. "I can't believe Jeremy co-chaired the campaign. He's always been a mensch, and now he's a real macher. You must be shepping so much nachas right now." So who, what type of person might say that? You can put it in the chat.
I'll read your chat answers when they appear. I don't see anything just yet, though. I wonder if our chat function is working. If you don't, if you can't see a chat function out there, then you can try just putting them into the Q&A box. Okay, I hear Booby Rose or Aita.
Yeah, we'll take that, Booby Rose. Okay, so some older people, especially women, might say this kind of quote, right? Next quote, "The sugya we're learning is too lumdish to say outside." Who would say that?
All right, I use the chat function. I'll read them out. The yeshivish bocher.
Yeah, exactly. In fact, that is a quote from a book called From Speak, Yeshivish. The First Dictionary of Yeshivish. Yeah. Next. Sorry, David, go ahead.
Just a Yinglish word, Yeshivish.
Yeah, yeah. "I spent the whole party schmoozing up the vice president. I must have given my spiel 6 times." Who would say that?
Waiting for them to come in a sec. Okay, a JNF worker, a jealous baba, a fundraiser.
That's interesting. So I think of this as something that could be anybody. It doesn't have to be Jewish or working at a Jewish organization, especially with the pronunciation of spiel, right? And notice it uses Yiddish words, but in slightly different ways than perhaps some Jews might say this quote. And finally, this one. "In the middle of the coldest weather, he crossed the ice in a little boat. He should catch the British and the missionaries fooling around, not with their minds on the war." Who would say that?
Give him a sec to click in. Okay, a Holocaust survivor from Germany. I see there's some last ones from last one. My parents, Jewish immigrant, Zadie, Moshe Slotnik, Dr. Ruth.
Yes, right. So these are exactly, this would be basically a Yiddish speaking immigrant who is speaking English not as their first language. And this quote happens to come from a book called The Education of Hyman Kaplan by Leo Rostin. So what do all of these quotes have in common? Well, they represent American English with Yiddish influences. And somebody who says one of these quotes would be unlikely to say any of the others. But this is an umbrella term for Yiddish influence. This idea of Yiddish influenced English is an umbrella term that includes American English, but 3 different types of American English: Yinglish, Yeshivish, and non-Orthodox Jewish English. And also American English is there because it includes Yiddish influences that are not specific to Jews. So I'm going to be talking about this today in multiple domains, in literature, spoken language, cultural products, and popular music. And I'm going to be giving some examples of how this plays out in songs. But first, a little history lesson about the history of the Yiddish language. What you see here is a map of the Middle East, North Africa, Europe, and parts of Asia. And you know that when Jews were living in the land of Israel and then they moved to the Babylonian Empire and the Persian Empire, to various places in that empire. And then from there, they moved to various places, including Italy and France. And from there, moved to Germany, what is now Germany, and from there to what is now Poland and the Ukraine and other parts of Eastern Europe. And in each of these places, they picked up languages. And the language of Yiddish is primarily Germanic, but is influenced by languages from all these other places that Jews lived, including Hebrew and Aramaic from the sacred texts, Romance languages like Judeo-French and Judeo-Italian, and Slavic languages from when the Jews moved from Germanic languages to Slavic lands and maintained their Germanic language, but incorporated elements from Slavic languages. So here's an example of how these components play out in Yiddish. So here's one sentence in Yiddish, der Zede hot gebencht chanekelicht. Now, if you look at what language each of these words come from, you'll see how the languages mix together. So you see that most of the words are from Germanic, and especially the function words, the little words like der, the. And so this means the grandpa blessed Hanukkah lights, or blessed the Hanukkah candles, right? And so you see that Zeta comes from Slavic, bench comes from Judeo-Italian, the word benedice, meaning to bless. Chanukah comes from Hebrew, of course, and all the other words come from German. Or here's another one, Hoben mir nigendel in Naches und in Frieden. It's a song, and it means we have a little tune in joy and pride. And here you can see that most of the words are also from Hebrew, from German, and two of them are from Hebrew. So this is not unusual. In many languages, there are influences from multiple languages. English in particular has a lot of these. It started out as an Anglo-Saxon language in England, and that is a Germanic language. And then at the Norman conquest and based on other contacts with other languages and the contact with Latin for scholarly and ecclesiastical purposes, other languages influenced this Anglo-Saxon base, forming what we now think of as English. And then when people from England moved to North America and people from all around the world moved to North America and picked up English, the English language then acquired influences from many other languages, including many Native American languages and immigrant languages from around Europe and other parts of the world, which included Yiddish. So when we think about Yiddish today, we have to think about it in two different ways, vernacular and post-vernacular, and I'll explain those. When we think about vernacular Yiddish, it is in decline. That means Yiddish as a spoken language, in decline, except in Hasidic communities. So most of the people who speak Yiddish outside of Hasidic communities are elderly. Most of the people who speak Yiddish in Hasidic communities are all different ages. Children are learning Yiddish in Hasidic communities today. In addition, there are small pockets of young non-Hasidic Jews who are maintaining Yiddish and teaching it to their children. However, when we talk about post-vernacular Yiddish, we see it's not in decline, it's actually quite vibrant. Most people who use Yiddish words and talk about Yiddish cannot understand full Yiddish sentences. This is the hallmark of post-vernacularity as conceptualized by the scholar named Jeffrey Chandler. And also the fact that something is said in Yiddish is more significant than what is actually said. Also, we see Yiddish-oriented metalinguistic communities, a term coined by my colleague Netta Avineri. And for example, we see Yiddish clubs and Yiddish classes and festivals. And these are people who convene around a language, even if they are not able to carry a full conversation in that language. They are celebrating the Yiddish language. So for example, we see all sorts of organizations and festivals and summer programs and classes and music involving Yiddish. And there's even the Yiddish farm in upstate New York where young people gather to learn Yiddish as they work on an active farm. But when we talk about the influences of Yiddish on English, we are entering a whole new domain, and we are talking about three different kinds. First, the Yiddish-influenced English spoken by immigrants. So I gave you an example before from that Leo Rosten book, but here's another example. This is from a 1928 book by Milt Gross. So Die Feucht Human Being, What It Existed, was entitled Hedem. So Hedem lived gradually in a place what it was, the Garden from Eden. So in the Garden from Eden was extremely gorgeous. It was there all kinds of fancy fruits. Okay, now in this quote, you see very few words that are actually Yiddish. In fact, no words, right? You see the influences are in the phonology, in the pronunciation, in the grammar, like saying what it was there, all kinds, and then some words like saying from instead of, all kinds of fancy fruits becomes all kinds from fancy fruits, because in Yiddish, from and of would be the same word, fun. So then we have to talk about another kind of Yiddish influenced English, which is today, contemporary communities and specifically Jewish English and American English. So in Jewish English, we have many words from Yiddish that are used primarily by Jews. So words like gefilte fish, macher, kvel, kvetch, and mensch. And then words that have spread beyond Jewish communities to the broader English language like bagel, maven, schmooze, klutz, and chutzpah. And I'll explain a little bit how these words have spread. One way that they've spread is media, such as this famous quote from Mike Myers performing Linda Richman on Saturday Night Live's sketch Coffee Talk, which was from the 1990s, getting a little verklempt, right? And here I'm gonna play an excerpt from President Obama, and you'll see how he uses this word.
Barbra Streisand attended her first Broadway show at age 14 and remembers thinking, I could go up on that stage and play any role without any trouble at all. That's what's called chutzpah. And it helps when you've got amazing talent, all of which made her a global sensation, one whose voice has been described as liquid diamonds, and whose fans have considered bronzing her used coffee cups. She has sold more albums in America than any woman in history. She has collected just about every honor and award that there is. I couldn't believe she hadn't gotten this one. Off the stage, she's been a passionate advocate for issues like heart disease and women's equality. I'm getting all verklempt just thinking about it.
Okay, so you see how here President Obama is using the words chutzpah and verklempt, but in the distinctive pronunciation that they are common among Americans beyond the Jewish community. So.
And Zion Pan. Oh. There's a man of large appetites.
Get out of here. Hold on. Okay, here we go. So now the question arises, how do these words diffuse from Jewish communities to the broader American population? And my answer to that is through three means: through social networks, through the media or popular culture, and through commodification. So first, social networks. Well, Yiddish-speaking immigrants have conversations with English-speaking Jews, especially the children and friends of immigrants, and then they have conversations with non-Jews. And throughout these overlapping social networks, words get transferred, words like klutz, putz, and maven. And then the media and entertainment and commodified products and metalinguistic discourse, that is, people talking about all these Yiddish words, help to solidify these words within the broader population. And so there you get words like pastrami, verklempt, and l'chaim. So just to give you some examples of commodification, you see this especially in the domain of food, where in the years of large Jewish communities on the Lower East Side, you would have kosher restaurants or Jewish restaurants that fostered the diffusion of words like kishke. And the word pastrami, many people don't even realize that this entered English through Yiddish. It's also a word in Romanian, but it seems that it was Romanian Jewish immigrants who brought it to the United States in their Yiddish language. And it became part of American culture, such that you even get this restaurant in Los Angeles that has Mexican food and burgers and pastrami. You certainly see this with bagel stores today, where many bagel stores commodify Yiddish words. Noah's Bagels, for example, even has a whole menu filled with Yiddish words, and the word schmear, bagel and schmear, has become part of the American cuisine. Here's a restaurant called Knish Nosh. I actually went into a restaurant called The Nosh in LA the other day, and I asked for a knish and they didn't even have them. So I bought a dozen bagels. And here's an interesting deli. This is a Jewish themed deli, and you see they are commodifying not only Yiddish words like pastrami, but also words like plots that have nothing to do with food. And you see the matzah balls, and look at that pastrami sandwich in the middle that says mazel tov. but even a Hebrew word, the word shalom. And so you see that Jewish language gets associated with deli and with Jewish restaurant. It also gets associated with certain TV shows and movies. So you see here a poster for Curb Your Enthusiasm, where Larry David is portrayed in profile saying oi. Now his character might not even say the word oi very much, but the word oi is associated with the New York Jewish way of speaking of Larry David. Another one is this Marvelous Mrs. Maisel ad from the Carnegie Deli. This was, I think, a pop-up version of the Carnegie Deli after it had closed. And it says, a sandwich worth the schlep. And so this character from a contemporary series on Amazon is using the Yiddish language to sell the series and using the series to sell these Jewish-oriented foods. So you see how Yiddish gets tied up in food and media more broadly. But you also have commodification in books that are sold that are about Yiddish or that are translations of English books into Yiddish. And I'll just give you a minute to look at these book covers here. So you also have commodification of the Yiddish language in other domains. And there's a great chapter on this in Chandler's book, Adventures in Yiddishland, where you have absolute tchotchke, right? And you have shirts with Yiddish words on them, sometimes in faux Hebrew lettering, faux Yiddish lettering, like that mensch shirt, or a toy that says schlep, or Yiddish refrigerator magnets, where you can't actually form a full Yiddish sentence. It's really Jewish English, and it's Yinglish. It's Yiddish-influenced English, and it only includes Yiddish words that are commonly known among Jews or non-Jews within American English. And you get this more recently. I spent way too much time recently looking at masks that have been created during the COVID pandemic that include Yiddish. And so you get ones that include words that we've already talked about, like that have become part of American English, like verklempt and oive, and this is making me schwitz. But then you also have masks that would be worn specifically by Yiddishists. For example, these the one on the left says schoin genug, enough, Black Lives Matter. And so you're seeing here Yiddish used in a political demonstration. On the right, you have bleibt mir gesund und stark, stay healthy, what is it? Stay healthy, strong, and I don't know why I'm craning my head because it's a picture, but and safe. And then on the bottom, Red mit mir Yiddish. So the one on the top is from the Yiddish Book Center, and notice it is written in transliteration. And the one on the bottom, Red mit mir Yiddish. Now you'd think, well, this is not post-vernacular. This is just vernacular because it's in Yiddish. And it's in Hebrew letters, and you wouldn't be able to understand it if you didn't speak Yiddish. True, but it's also post-vernacular in that it is talking about Yiddish. It's making a metalinguistic statement about the Yiddish language, like, I want to speak Yiddish to you. You wouldn't see that in a Hasidic community where Yiddish is used as a vernacular because they wouldn't need it because it is just the language that they use. And sometimes you see commodified versions of Yiddish that involve mistakes, like this mask that says NYC crotch. Why? Because this mask producer was trying to make NYC strong in multiple languages, but wrote it backwards. It should have said stark, and instead it says crotch. Okay, so now how is Yiddish-influenced English developing today? Well, many words are decreasing, words like macher, kepi, nachis, hamish, and bashert. And you associated these words at the beginning with older people, older Jews, and that's accurate. In fact, for example, the word macher, if you look, this is from a survey that I conducted about a decade ago. If you look at the age distribution of who reports using the word macher, you see that it is much less common among Jewish respondents. It's much less common among younger Jewish respondents than older Jewish respondents. Okay, but you also see the opposite trend, that some Yiddish words in English are actually increasing, like shul, bench, lane, and daven. Now, what do these have in common? Well, they are in the religious domain. Shul means synagogue, bench means blessed, lane means to read Torah or Haftorah or something like that, and daven means to pray. And here's an example. This is the percent of Jews who report using the word shul. And you see the complete opposite progression, that younger Jews are more likely to report using it than older Jews. And I actually remember when I transitioned from saying synagogue to shul. I used to say synagogue when I was in high school. And by the time I was in college or maybe grad school, I had transitioned to saying I'm going to shul. So when we're talking about Jewish English, I want to distinguish between two different types. I've been focusing on the non-Orthodox Jewish English, but there's also yeshivish or Orthodox Jewish English, which is heavily influenced by Yiddish. And you see this in words like mamish, meaning really, mirtz Hashem, meaning with God's help, machlokes, meaning argument, shalashudis, meaning the third meal of Shabbos that is eaten, a light meal on Saturday evening. Shabbosim, the plural of Shabbases, right? To be zoche. So you see this periphrastic construction of a Hebrew word with the phrase to be, which is influenced by the parallel construction in Yiddish, and the word chiddush, which means an innovative point. And then you also get a bunch of Yiddish words that are not of Hebrew origin, like tish, which means table in Yiddish, but in Orthodox Jewish English, or Jewish English more broadly, means a celebration around a table, like a chosin's tish or a rebbe's tish, a groom's celebration or a Hasidic rebbe's celebration. The word blech, meaning a piece of metal placed over a stove to enable slow cooking throughout Shabbos without turning on and off the stove. The word take, meaning really. Steig, meaning to rise, but is used in Orthodox Jewish English to mean to study. Ständer, which is a podium, and fleischig, meals that are meat-filled. Now, it's not just words that are influenced from Yiddish into Jewish English among Orthodox Jews. It's also grammatical constructions like, I want that you should see this, and this is not what to record. Or a phrase like, learn out. What do we learn out from this? Or it was given over to Moshe. And then also ones that people often don't even think about as being from Yiddish, like, when are you coming to us for lunch? Or who are you staying by for Shabbos? And you see this interesting age trend as well, that the phrase staying by us is much, much more common among younger Orthodox Jews than older Orthodox Jews. This has become a marker of Orthodox identity, so much so that people who are not, who didn't grow up Orthodox but join Orthodox communities, pick up this phrase and often say it. But it's not just words or grammar, it's also pronunciation, like devoicing, saying going instead of going, or beert instead of beard, or intonation. If you've heard it, you know what I'm talking about. Or even lighter versions of that, like, if you've heard it, you know what I'm talking about, which is influenced by both Talmud study, where they need to use their intonation patterns to indicate the phrase boundaries because there's no punctuation in the Talmud. But it's also influenced from Yiddish, which has that similar intonation pattern. Now I'm going to show how a lot of these trends that I've been talking about play out in songs. And I'm going to be showing you, I'm going to be playing some songs by Mickey Katz and Seymour Rechtzeit in Yinglish, and then some songs by Country Yossi and Journeys in Yeshivish. So I want you to listen to the similarities in these songs and how they use Yiddish words, and then also the differences in how the Yinglish is different from the Yeshivish, specifically because the Yinglish would include audience members who actually spoke Yiddish, whereas in the Yeshivish songs, the audience members mostly do not speak Yiddish, and the influences are primarily in words. Now, those of you listening later on YouTube will not hear these songs because of copyright issues, but those of you who are here now will. And so if you're joining us on YouTube, just don't worry about the sound going out for a minute. It will come back after the songs. Here's the first one by Mickey Katz, who was actually American born, but grew up in a Yiddish speaking community in Cleveland and had a great command of the Yiddish language as well as of the Yinglish of immigrants.
Born in the wilds of the Lancy Street, home of gefilte fish and kosher meat. Handy mit a knife for hairs your teeth. He flicked him a chicken when he was only three.
Dove Crockett.
He sat in the sun and geracket in gebacket.
Dove Crockett. King of the Lancy Street.
In 1813 he fought in the annals. Then came the Litvaks and the Galicianers, a figure hugged Redskins all over the shtetl. He never lost his head, he never lost his shtetl.
Dove Crockett.
He chewed tobacco and gehissed and gerackett.
Dove Crockett.
King of the Lensis Tree.
Okay, now I included this song, even though it has this problematic part about fighting Indians, right, and killing Redskins. It's very offensive, right? But I wanted to include it in this talk because Professor David Kaufman has done a lot of research on Jewish Indian connections. And I thought it would be nice to include that in our conversation afterwards. But you see here that there are many words from Yiddish, but also even full phrases like hot er geharget, so he killed, right? And that is not a phrase that has become part of Jewish English more broadly. Some of them are like shtetl and shetel, right? But others are not, like gehistun gechraket. These are not loan words that have become part of Jewish English more broadly. The next song that I want to play is by Seymour Rechtzeit, who was actually born in Poland, but grew up primarily in America, and he learned English in a perfect way, so you wouldn't even know that he was an immigrant. So he had great command of both the English and the Yiddish languages. And the song that I want to play is Shicker Ticker, which is a parody of The Syncopated Clock by Leroy Anderson. So both this and the Mickey Katz song are parodies of songs that were quite popular at the time.
Yitzhak had a geschäft in Gubernia Bialystok. He loved his schnapps like a good Litvak, but his greatest love was to fix a clock. Now Avrum Yitzhak once last year had schnapps gemischt mit a bottle full of beer. Was hot passiert to his career, made Avrum schreißes a klug zu mir.
Okay, so what you saw in that song was, again, a bunch of words like schrei has become part of Jewish English, and so have schnapps and litvak, but you also have phrases that have not, like hot schnapps gemischt mit. This is almost a full sentence, and was hot passiert, sie ist geklopft zu mir. These phrases would really be hard to understand if I didn't provide the translation here, right? But at the time when these songs were written and performed, a lot of the audience members would have still had enough Yiddish knowledge to understand them. So now I'm going to play some songs in Yeshivish. The first one is by a band called Country Yossi and the Stiebelhoppers. And this is a parody of a 1961 song, Big Bad John by Jimmy Dean. And this one is called Big Bad Moish.
Every morning in the shtiebel you could see him arrive. He stood 6'6", weighed 245. Kind of broad at the girdle and hairy at the lip. And everybody knew you didn't pull no shtick with Big Moish.
Big Moish.
Big bad moish.
Big moish.
No one seemed to know where Moish called home. He just drifted into shul and davened alone. Didn't say much, just a mane here and there. And if he'd said shalom, he'd pretend not to hear. Big Moish. Some people said he lived in Borough Park, where he liked to roam the streets after dark. And he once got jumped by three Ville de Fer, but they all ended up teeth in drear. Big Moish.
Big Moish. Big Moish.
Big bad Moish.
Okay, so you see here that the words that are used from Yiddish are primarily single words, words like shul and davened. And you see how davened is even integrated into the English grammatical structure with the ed after the verb, right? And you see some words from Hebrew like amen and shalom, and also words like shtibel, gartel, and shtick, which are common in Orthodox communities. And then you also have some phrases like wilde Pferd or tiefen Drehrt, but these Yiddish phrases are single phrases that have become part of Jewish English. And the final song that I want to play for you today is by A.B. Rotenberg and the band Journeys. It's a song called Yeshivisha Raid, which means Yeshivish speech. And in this one, you're going to hear more words from Yiddish, but you'll see that they are still singular words.
To originate a language, a new way to talk and speak, is a most imposing challenge, a monumental feat. It takes a special talent, is not for the faint of heart, and most are doomed to failure before they even start. But in the hallowed halls of yeshivos far and wide, our young men have discovered a new way to verbalize. With Yiddish, English, Hebrew, it's a mixture of all three, and a dash of Aramaic, a linguistic potpourri that's called
It's not too close. Okay, and it goes on and it has, you know, it lists more phrases that are used in Yeshivish. And so you might say, well, this one has so many words, it's even more Yiddish influenced, but I would argue that it's still single phrases that have become part of Orthodox Jewish English. And most of the grammatical structure is still English, right? You don't get those function words that you got in the Mickey Katz and Simor Rechtzeit songs. So let's just summarize this comparison. You see that they actually deal with slightly different topics, that the Mickey Katz and Simor Rechtzeit songs deal with food and the immigrant experience, and the Country Yossi and Journey songs deal with, well, Orthodox things like learning and praying. Are there sentences or words in the Mickey Katz and Simor Rechtzeit songs? Both. And in the Yeshivish songs, really words or short phrases. In the Yinglish songs, you have some function words like mit, meaning with, and un, meaning and you don't get that in the Yeshivish ones. In the Yinglish songs, you get some Yiddish phonology and syntax, and hardly at all in the Yeshivish songs. And so what we see here is a transition from Yiddish-influenced English, where Yiddish is the base language, and then people have learned English and maintained some of those grammatical influences from Yiddish, to a Jewish English that is common several generations after immigration, where the Yiddish influences are a little bit more based on words than on grammar. Now, Yiddish-influenced English continues to develop in America today. Some words are changing in meaning and usage. For example, the word schmooze means to chat, right? But in American English, more generally, it also means to network. And it's become transitive. You don't just schmooze with someone, you schmooze someone, right? That is a change in meaning. And this is common when languages come into contact and one word goes from one language to another, that its meaning often and usage often change. Another example is schlep, which has a similar transitive change. It used to be that you schlep something. Now you can schlep, like I schlepped all the way here from the valley, right? That kind of intransitive usage, you don't get that in Yiddish. You can schlep yourself, sich schleppen, but you don't just say schlep, right? Or tisch, which now doesn't just mean table, but also that celebration around a table. And even the word bench, which I mentioned before, it doesn't just mean bless in Jewish English. It also means to say grace after meals, specific type of blessing, right? And finally, chutzpah, which in Yiddish is mostly negative, but in Jewish English is also positive, such that Oprah Winfrey had the chutzpah awards that was celebrating people's nerve, right? Now you also get some interesting Yiddish English cultural production. And I'll give you just a few examples. There was a movie called The Hebrew Hammer, which either you love it or you hate it. I love it because it has a lot of interesting things to analyze, like a lot of Yiddish words such as schlep and babbele, and grammatical constructions like eat by us, or you want I should talk dirty to you, or even influences in the pronunciation. Instead of saying the hood, saying the chud, or instead of Hebrew, Hebrew, sort of a, you know, over the top parody of Yiddish influenced English. And you get this in various types of young adult oriented Jewish culture, such as a magazine that was published a few years ago or several years ago called Hebe Magazine, that had the whole Megillah as a section and the Nosh Pit, a section about food, and Urban Kvetch, which was a pun on Urban Fetch, a short-lived New York delivery service using these Yiddish words. You also get Yiddish words in this book, Cool Jew, the Ultimate Guide for Every Member of the Tribe, with words like shtender, kishkes, bubby, naches, shul, and then also phonological influences like the kind of Yinglish you would expect from the immigrant generation, like don't worry, or a recurring sidebar, FYI, for the Yiddish impaired. You also get some interesting Yiddish cultural production, sometimes with more or less English. A great example of this, and since I'm speaking in Canada right now, I've got to bring in this wonderful Canadian comedy duo, Yid Life Crisis. And I'm just going to show a little excerpt from one of their videos that also includes Mayim Bialik.
Okay, so as our mothers may have discussed, I'm interested in leading a traditional Jewish life. I'm seeking candidates. I know exactly what I want. I have all the questions to ask right off the bat. So blind dates is just a more efficient way of, you know, seeing if this is even possible. So, you understand.
Totally get it. Fire away.
Well, the first question is a new one. What's he doing here?
Oh, hey, yeah,
Ist was bin ich schon dein Kind hätte?
Machen uns stell, als du bist der Koine. Ob es geht schlecht, schlepp mich nach Haus. Ob es geht geht, schlepp sich nach Haus.
Was krieg ich von dem?
Ich will machen von dir die Steigerung von den letzten 3 Jahren zurück.
Ask him.
I just ran into my buddy Laser here out front, and I've never seen a kosher California roll, so.
Are you Jewish?
Depends on your definition.
Of course he's Jewish. We went to Hebrew school together for 17 years.
It's not a black and white question.
What's your name?
Jaime.
Single?
Depends on your definition.
Okay, let's get started. How do you feel about children? Yes, no, how many?
Excellent question. I'd like at least 2 children, possibly 3, God willing, at least a boy and a girl, so as the Talmud says, to replace ourselves on earth and continue the traditions of our fathers and matrilineal descent.
Good. And you?
I just came for the sushi.
You don't want children?
No, I might want, I don't know. I think the question in and of itself is ridiculous.
Excuse me?
Well, I just mean you're looking for a potential spouse here. Is the relationship between the two of you not going to play into any of this?
I'm going to get there.
Well, you're the one that said you had no time.
He has mild hypoglycemia, actually. Can we have some sushi?
No, I appreciate the honesty. How do you feel about eating kosher? In, out of the house?
Well, you see, the Bible was written by a cabal of sages, let's call them, who used a story and narrative based in Bronze Age polytheism, mythology.
I'm so sorry, my mother is calling. I better get this. Hello, Ma. The house smells nicht. Yeah, yeah. Sie sagt, was du kannst nicht leiden. Wenn sie sagt, was ich will, als ich bei dir, geh weg, Mami.
So sorry. My mother too, I got up.
Yeah.
Yo, Mami, entschuldig mir, aber ich will bleiben.
Steitschigkeit ist erotisch.
Sie ist nicht für dich, sie ist für mich.
Ja,
verschwind, Mama.
Verstehe.
Ich glaube, dass wir zwei Schmänderiges, die meinen, dass ich red nicht kein Jiddisch und Pater in unserer Zeit.
I'll call you back.
Roman.
Okay, so this is an interesting example of contemporary Yiddish production, right? It's most of the episodes are actually primarily in Yiddish. This one has a little bit more English, but they use Yiddish in interesting ways, and it's clearly post-vernacular in that it. One of the funny things about these sketches is that they're speaking Yiddish, right? And there are subtitles so that people will understand who don't actually speak Yiddish. But the fact that they're doing this in Yiddish is a culturally important phenomenon. And it's not the only contemporary example of this. There are many others, such as In Geveb, a journal of Yiddish studies, which celebrates and analyzes Yiddish, and it's mostly produced by young people, and Weibelteich, a Yiddish podcast where women speak to women all in Yiddish. So what's going on here? Is Yiddish cool? Well, yeah, Yiddish has become cool. Why is this? Why are some young Jews expressing renewed interest in Yiddish language and culture? Well, there's a few reasons. One is the expanding salad bar, I would call it, of Jewish expression. There are many ways to be Jewish and do Jewish, and this is just one of the many alternative outlets. Also, Jews now feel increasingly comfortable in America. We have experienced several generations from the mass wave of immigration, and there's no longer this sense of insecurity surrounding how your parents speak in this different way. And there's a desire to get back to the language spoken by their grandparents, great-grandparents, and beyond. There's also a broader American historical trajectory, which is an increase in ethnic pride and multiculturalism since the 1960s. In the late 1960s, it became cool to have something distinctively ethnic about you. And since then, Yiddish has become much more acceptable than it was before then. And finally, Yiddish has become associated with progressive Jewish expression, and in particular with queer Jewish expression, especially among Jews who are queer, gay and lesbian and transgender and do not feel comfortable in traditional Jewish spaces. The Yiddish world provides a space where many of them do feel more comfortable. And I want to end by just highlighting some contemporary Yiddish cultural production that has to do with Hasidim or Haredim, such as Romeo and Juliet in Yiddish, and Felix and Meira, and the Netflix series Unorthodox, and the Israeli show Shtisel, which all have a lot of Yiddish in them. And actually, I recently watched the last episode of season 3 of Shtisel. No spoilers, don't worry, but I will just give you a little forespies that in the last episode, there is even some talk of secular Yiddish literature. So to conclude, I will read this quote from H.B. Wells, not to be confused with H.G. Wells, from 1928. In an essay entitled Notes on Yiddish, he wrote, "Judeo-German in America is inevitably doomed." And by Judeo-German, he's referring to Yiddish. "There is no reasonable doubt that American Yiddish will, within a very few years, lose its identity, at least as Judeo-German, will turn into Judeo-English, expire quietly, and finally become as delightfully musty and passé a subject for doctor's theses as Anglo-Saxon is today." Well, what do you think? Was H.B. Wells right? Well, I mean, he was certainly wrong that American Yiddish will expire, right? Because it's still used by Hasidim today. And he was right that it turned into Judeo-English, that it turned into these Yiddish-influenced Englishes. He was wrong that it will expire quietly. As you saw, it is diminishing in certain ways, but expanding in other ways. But I do agree with him that it is a great topic for a doctoral thesis. I think it's a great topic for a talk like this one today, where we saw all these examples of Yiddish-influenced English. And here is what my doctoral dissertation became, my first book, Becoming From. And I've also created an online dictionary of Jewish English. It's called the Jewish English Lexicon, and it includes not only words from Yiddish, but also words from Hebrew, Aramaic, Ladino, and other languages, and it's crowdsourced. So if you see a word that is, if you know a word that's not in there, then you are welcome to add it. So I encourage you to visit that site, learn some Yinglish words, some Hebrewish words, and help us to expand that lexicon. Thank you very much.
Sarah, thank you so much. That was so fascinating. A wonderful mapping of a post-vernacular Yiddish world. It's a very fun show and tell, of course, but underneath the fun of it, you provided like fascinating barrage really of linguistic insights from sociolinguistics, historical linguistics. I heard some morphology and some phonology in there, syntax, metalinguistics. Thanks too for that Mickey Katz, David Crockett shout out. It's an amazing source I'd never heard before. It was a wonderful talk. I have many, many questions, but I'm going to hang on to them. And I will tell all of our guests to hang on to their questions as well. We're going to take a 5-minute pause, and then we're going to come back and we'll hear from our next speaker, from Eddy Portnoy, and then we'll save up all your questions and we'll get to it in the discussion. So if you want to get onto the Q&A now, you can plop them in there and we'll be sure to come back. Thank you again, Professor Benor, and I will see you all in 5 minutes, let's say at five after five in Eastern Standard Time.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back from our quick break. And I'm delighted to welcome you to the second part of this wonderful program and to introduce our next speaker, Eddy Portnoy. Eddy Portnoy is the academic advisor and director of exhibitions at the YIVO Institute for Jewish Research. He created acclaimed exhibits for YIVO on broad and diverse range of topics, such as rare rabbinic texts, Jews in space, and Yiddish typewriters. Many of you have read his contributions to the Forward and Tablet, and some of you have seen his articles in academic journals where he writes on aspects of Jewish popular culture. I tell my students not to read Wikipedia, not to use it on papers, but I can't resist this. If you've read the Wikipedia entry on Eddy Portnoy, you will learn that he's, quote, considered Chelm's leading expert on Yiddish humor. His 2017 book, Bad Rabbi and Other Strange But True Stories from the Yiddish Press, focuses on the seamy underbelly of Jewish life. I'm so pleased that he's joined us today to speak to us on bringing the ruckus to Yiddishland, Yiddish and its vocabulary of violence. Eddy, yours.
Thanks so much, Sarah. And thanks to everyone else at York and the audience as well. I wish I could have been in Toronto. The Leafs are doing well. Things seem, look, they're looking up. Also, I didn't write that Wikipedia entry. Okay, so let me begin, I guess, by sharing my screen, which is the way we're supposed to always start these things. Okay, here we go. The Yiddish-speaking Jews are known for a variety of accomplishments, among them producing some excellent literature. Shalom Aleichem, Yud Lamed Peretz, and Isaac Bishevis Singer, maybe some names that come to mind. Among other matters, Yiddish-speaking Jews are also known for their humor, for their theater, and for the music they created. Such a list of things that developed out of Yiddish culture can really go on and on. However, one thing that Yiddish-speaking Jews are not known to have produced is great legions of warriors. As far as we're aware, there is no Velvel the Lionhearted or a Muttle the Hun that led hordes of Yiddish-speaking warriors which conquered other lands and other peoples. And when you think of Yiddish culture, you don't typically think of bloody brawls, violent mobs, and street fighting. Stereotypes that do exist concerning Yiddish-speaking Jews tend much more toward physical weakness and a relentless fear of Cossacks. If you add a large dollop of intellectuality, a heaping portion of religious tradition, and then sprinkle liberally with humor and jokes, you've got what people think are the alphas and omegas of Yiddish culture. The problem with this, of course, as with all stereotypes, is that none of them are terribly accurate. While there are kernels of truth to all of them, there aren't enough to make blanket generalizations with any precision. Still, people rely on stereotypes as a kind of cultural shorthand because they allow people to think they've got something figured out without actually having to know very much. And even though stereotypes are often wrong, they're also notoriously difficult to break. The reality is that Yiddish is a language like all others in which all emotions are expressed. Qualities like humor, anger, or melancholy all depend on the speaker, not the language, which is simply a tool used to communicate these ideas. Before World War II, when Yiddish culture was at its peak and about 75% of Jews worldwide spoke the language, it was perhaps not as easy to pigeonhole Yiddish as a vehicle used mainly for humor. Today, when only a memory of mass culture still exists, we seem to have only been left with the remnants of Catskills comedy. Not that there's anything wrong with that. After all, who doesn't like a good laugh? But it's quite simply a false representation of historical reality to typecast Yiddish in any particular way. The scholars who founded the YIVO Institute for Jewish Research in 1925 understood this. They knew that Yiddish culture was a broad universe unto itself, which is why they created an organization to study all aspects of it, from its folklore and music, to its linguistics and literature, to its history and the psychology of its speakers. They saw an inherent value in the culture of Yiddish-speaking Jews, the same way other peoples viewed their own cultures. Ironically, perhaps many people, and really many Jews among them, did not see Yiddish as having any value. They saw it as a crude jargon, a patchwork culture that was backward and ugly and certainly not worth preserving. But as I said, the YIVO didn't see it that way. They took pride in Yiddish and the thousand-year culture that Yiddish-speaking Jews created. So they collected and they analyzed, eager to document and preserve the products of this culture. Sadly, only about 15 years after they began their work, Yiddish and most of its speakers would be decimated in the Holocaust. But the scholarly studies YIVO produced and those which survivors and compatriots continued to produce after the war reveal the incredible breadth of Yiddish culture. Part of that breadth can be found within the Yiddish language itself. Language, after all, is a vehicle that carries human culture. Because it was the most significant Jewish language of the period and the most predominant one in the place they lived, it made sense that the scholars who worked at the YIVO would place a strong emphasis on it as a vehicle for study. In 1926, YIVO produced its first publication, a linguistics anthology called Philologische Schriften. This is what the cover looks like. Philologische Schriften means writings on philology. This is a thick tome that included an array of scholarly articles on the Yiddish language, ranging from topics like noun declension in 17th century Yiddish to Yiddish dialects in Estonia, among other numerous others. Considering the highly esoteric nature and of these linguistic studies, it was a bit of a surprise to find a short article in the anthology entitled Wörter auf Schlagen, or fighting words. Yiddish fighting words? This is what the first page of the article looks like. Yiddish fighting words, what does that even mean? How large a vocabulary of violence could this so-called shtetl language have? What kinds of Jews needed a special lexicon to describe the specifics of assault and battery? Well, in case you're unawares, we can take a look at a few examples from Yiddish newspapers. And this first one I'm going to read is from the Jewish Daily Forward, or the Vorwärts, and it's from 1907. The article reads as follows. Yom Kippur services in a Clinton Street hall were disrupted due to a fight over a chair. When Joseph Rand showed up in Shul with his family, he discovered that one Herman Garber was sitting in one of the seats he had reserved. Rand informed Garber that he was in one of his seats, but Garber produced a ticket indicating that Rand was wrong and that it was, in fact, his seat. Rand responded by driving his fist into Garber's face. Not to be outdone, Garber tore out part of Rand's beard. The lion-like voice of the cantor was drowned out by the screams and howls of the fighting congregants. In the end, both Rand and Garber were forced to finish the Musaf service in Essex Market Court, where they were both held under arrest. I'm going to read another one from the same newspaper, the Vorwärts, from 1913. 18-year-old Esther Goldberg, a pretty girl who lives at 20 Pitt Street on the Lower East Side, went out early in the morning to the grocery store to get some rolls for breakfast. Suddenly, she saw her neighbor, a young tailor by the name of Harris Bloom, being attacked by a thief, who popped him so hard on the head he couldn't see straight. The thief grabbed Bloom's money and took off. Miss Goldberg, a Cossack of a girl, gave chase. She caught up with the mugger on Grand Street and slugged him so hard she knocked him to the ground. With that, she jumped on top of him and pounded him with her fist until he saw stars. The thief was only saved because the police showed up and pulled her off of him. The last one I'm going to read is from 1926, and it's from Warsaw, from the daily newspaper Heint. An aspiring film actress, Miral Wolfson, was engaged to the 31-year-old driver, Yisroel Mucha. Her two brothers, Moshe and Eliezer, were opposed to the match and wanted her to marry their friend, Chaim Blochzilber. But their sister was categorically opposed to dumping her fiancé. She told the story to Mucha that her brothers were trying to convince her to marry someone else. On account of this, Mucha stopped going to the Wolfson's home and instead waited for his fiancée by the building's front gate. While Wolfson went out to see Mucha by the gate, her two brothers, together with Blochzilber, ran ahead and attacked Mucha, beating him badly. Mucha, however, fought back and in the yard of 17 Krochmalna Street, he stuffed one of his attackers into a barrel of herring, another into a garbage can, and the third he left lying in a cellar. Mucha himself ended up with 7 wounds to the head. Now, these articles may not describe the kinds of Yiddish speakers one expects from the pre-war generation. But not only do such Jews exist, they do so in large numbers. It would, however, be very easy to miss this aspect of Jewish history. Not much of Yiddish literature nor Yiddish theater have very many knockdown, drag-out fight scenes. Sholem Aleichem doesn't describe Tevye popping Laser Wolf on the nose when they argued. And Marc Chagall never depicted people duking it out as they floated above the shtetl. The very issue of Jews and violence generally concerns the idea that they were on the receiving end, mostly of anti-Semitic attacks. Eastern European Jews are thus not well known for Jew-on-Jew violence, but it existed, as noted, on a large scale. Yiddish newspapers from New York to Minsk contain reports of all manner of violent activities involving only Jews. Jews, after all, are people, and people fight. And Yiddish-speaking Jews, in spite of the aforementioned stereotypes, fought quite a lot. Now, coincidentally, the scholars who work at the YIVO were deeply interested in the cultures of the Amcho, the common folk, or the specifically Jewish unwashed rabble, whose bad language and short temper sometimes launched clenched fists into mouthfuls of rotten teeth. Whether it was in the shtetl marketplace or on Essex and Grand on the Lower East Side, working class Jews let their fingers do the walking and their fists do the talking. YIVO's academic mandate, after all, was to study all Jews, not just the elites, the rabbis, the scholars, artists, business people, and such. And all Jews meant people like criminals and other kinds of urban detritus who could be found duking it out on the streets of Warsaw and Vilna. Not that fighting is necessarily such an integral part of the Yiddish cultural experience, but as with all cultures, it exists. And to deny that fact means ignoring what was really a common feature of Jewish life. Now, during the late 19th and early 20th centuries, when masses of East European Jews migrated to the continent's big cities and to other far-flung locales, North America mainly, Jews packed poor and working class neighborhoods. On the lowest rungs of the economic ladder, they created the ghettos known as the Lower East Side and in North Warsaw, among many other urban centers throughout the world. The Jewish immigrant underclass filled grimy sweatshops and cramped tenements. They bought their dinners out of barrels and off of pushcarts. They fought tooth and nail with their bosses and their landlords. They manned the picket lines and they battled with gangsters, hired goons, and the police. Crammed into poor neighborhoods like herring in a barrel, they also fought amongst themselves and with their non-Jewish neighbors. With personal space at a premium in a place like this, you could expect to get knocked down or even knocked out if you got in someone else's face. The stories of homey Jewish immigrant neighborhoods where wholesome families got pickles from a barrel and enjoyed an evening out at the Yiddish theater still hold strong. But the reality of those depictions should also be accompanied by descriptions like this one by Mike Gold, who in his book, Jews Without Money, chronicled his childhood on the Lower East Side during its immigrant heyday. And it goes as follows. I could never forget the East Side where I lived as a boy. It was a block from the notorious Bowery, a tenement canyon hung with fire escapes, bed clothing, and faces. Always these faces at the tenement windows. The street never failed them. It was an immense excitement. It never slept. It roared like a sea. It exploded like fireworks. People pushed and wrangled in the street. There were armies of howling pushcart peddlers. Women screamed, dogs barked and copulated, babies cried. A parrot cursed. Ragged kids played under truck horses. Fat housewives fought from stoop to stoop. A beggar sang. At the livery stable, coach drivers lounged on a bench. They hee-hawed with laughter. They guzzled cans of beer. Pimps, gamblers, and red-nosed bums, peanut politicians, pugilists in sweaters, tin-horned sports and tall longshoremen in overalls, an endless pageant of East Side life passed through the wicker doors of Jake Wolf's saloon. Whirlwinds of dust and newspaper. The prostitutes laughed shrilly. A prophet passed, an old clothes Jew with a white beard. Kids were dancing around the hurdy-gurdy. Two bums slugged each other. Excitement, dirt, fighting, chaos. The sound of my street sounded like the blast of a great carnival or catastrophe. The noise was always in my ears. It's the end of the quote. Violence in these neighborhoods occurred not only in connection to crime, but also in the sphere of interpersonal relations. As noted, the Yiddish papers of the 1920s and 30s are full of reports of furious Jew-on-Jew violence, attacks that took place between all kinds of Jews. Slaps, punches, and kicks functioned within daily discourse as an emphatic way in which to get one's point across. Before Jews entered the middle classes, low-level violence as a form of conflict resolution was remarkably common. Talk back to your Yiddish-speaking mother, expect to get slapped. Smart off to someone in the street, you're going to get shoved or punched. These are, of course, not the elements of life most memoirists have chosen to recall. As they made their way up the social and economic ladder, Jews purposely forgot this kind of unsavory behavior. And with most North American Jews firmly situated in the middle class, a place where people aren't supposed to behave violently, this kind of physical discourse has mostly disappeared, at least from public view. As is evident, life for working class Jews during the late 19th and early 20th centuries was no picnic, and the Jews themselves knew that their close-quartered, high-intensity lives needed an outlet. Their hard-fought leisure time needed entertainment, theater, Nickelodeons, carnivals, freak shows, parks, picnics, and of course, sports as both players and viewers. Fighting on the streets and in the ring was part of this general scheme of entertainment. The kids who grew up around this everyday violence also participated in it. One of the interviewees in Irving Howe's book, How We Lived, which focuses on Lower East Side memories, includes that of Samuel Goldenberg, who described how he felt about the violence in the neighborhood. It goes as follows. Our heroes were great fighters, strong-arm hoodlums who were top gangsters. Wrongly, we tried to emulate them. Police and law enforcement officers were our enemies. We were continually at war between ourselves and with gangs from other districts that were of different races and religions. The Irish gangs came from the East Side waterfront. They invaded our district with rocks, glass bottles, clubs, and all sorts of homemade weapons. Battles would rage in the streets, vacant lots, and even in some of the parks. Sometimes they lasted for hours until the police would break them up. My East Side slum training stood me in good stead later in my life. The constant fighting with different gangs toughened me to withstand the blows that life would deal me. My single-handed fights with other kids, Jewish or otherwise, just for the sheer joy of supremacy, gave me the knowledge of self-defense and boxing. Now, the kind of street violence that Goldenberg describes here and which occurs in poor neighborhoods is typically very much feared by authorities, and attempts have consistently been made to sublimate it into sport. 100 years ago, it was very much the same thing among Jews in impoverished neighborhoods in places like New York and Warsaw. Boxing, for example, became an enormously popular outlet, and many Jewish boys and girls took boxing classes at places like the Educational Alliance and the YWHA. And here are just a couple of examples of this. This is a boxing match at the Educational Alliance sometime during the 1930s on the Lower East Side. I guess these kids have to be, you know, 10, 11, 12 years old, something like that. And then we also have a photograph from around 1920 of a women's boxing class from the YWHA in Washington Heights, which is in Northern Manhattan. And what's interesting about this is you typically don't think of women from this period, you know, involved in fighting or boxing, but here you have photographic evidence. Now, some of the boys who from New York's Jewish neighborhoods were who were engaged in boxing were good enough to turn pro, and many of them did. Names like Abe Attell, Ruby Goldstein, Benny Leonard, Sid Terrace, Barney Ross, Maxie Rosenblum, and dozens of others were on the cards of professional boxing matches. One reporter claimed in the mid-1920s that lightweight champion Benny Leonard was more popular among Jews than Albert Einstein. It's also estimated that one third of professional boxers in the 1920s and 30s in the United States were Jews. And if you take a look at Ring Magazine, which was boxing's major publication at the time, it reveals a huge number of Jewish boxers, not only in New York, but in every city that had a Jewish immigrant underclass. And I can show you a couple of covers of the Ring. You know, this is from 1925. Ruby Goldstein is on the cover. He was a great flyweight. This one has Corporal Izzy Schwartz. He was in the Armory, so he's known as the Corporal, but another, you know, great Jewish boxer. This last one is of Maxie Rosenblum, who's one of the rare Jewish heavyweights. He's also also became an actor, a very, very well-known figure in, let's say, 1930s U.S. entertainment, you know, sport and entertainment. Now, less well-known than the Jewish boxers in America were the Jewish boxers in Poland, whose history has largely been obscured by the Holocaust. But just like in the States, dozens of Jewish boxers fought professionally in Poland, fighting mainly out of politicized Jewish youth movements like Maccabi and Linka Polit Zion, or Left Labor Zionist, which actually had the best boxing team in interwar Poland. The most successful among these Polish Jewish boxers was Szepsel Rotholz, who became a Polish national flyweight champion and was the first Jew to be accepted onto the Polish national team. Now, while Jewish involvement in boxing has mostly been pretty well researched, the activity of Jews in professional wrestling, which I guess you could consider boxing's ugly stepbrother, since it's not, it's less of a sport than a predetermined sport spectacle. But professional wrestling, or Jewish involvement in professional wrestling, is far less well researched than boxing. However, from the 1920s through the 1950s, dozens of Jews worked as professional wrestlers, as heroes and as heels, wrestling under names like the Hebrew Hercules or the Jewish Tarzan. Wrestlers like A.B. Coleman and Herbie Freeman, among many others, drew legions of Jewish fans to wrestling matches as well. Jewish wrestlers were so popular that at one point there were Gentiles that wrestled under Jewish names, pretending to be Jewish, just so they could attract the Jewish audience, which was also very significant. And I can show you a couple of examples. This is Max Krauser. Max Krauser got his, he was from Lodz, Poland. His real name is Mendel Krauser. He got his start in Poland. He was a professional wrestler there. He did very well. He wound up winning the European Championship, which is held in Sweden in 1935. In 1939, he was on a wrestling tour in Australia when World War II broke out. He wasn't able to get back to Poland, and so he went on to the United States and became a professional wrestler there. You also have figures like Hank Barber, who, and you can see on his trunks, he has a Star of David. He was a college football player and wrestler who eventually became a professional wrestler as well. Also, you have A.B. Coleman. A.B. Coleman was also, he was born in Poland, emigrated to the United States just after World War I. Although I think he briefly, if I remember correctly, he briefly lived in Canada. And he became a very well-regarded, well-known Jewish professional wrestler. He was known as the Jewish Tarzan. And if you read the newspapers, the sports pages of the newspapers of the day, you could find all of these figures in them. Now, in cities like Warsaw and Lodz, wrestling also drew large numbers of Jewish fans. Wrestlers like Avram Wildman, whose image was sold on postcards next to Jewish icons like Sholem Aleichem and Theodor Herzl, were enormously popular. And Wildman, for example, was followed through the streets of Warsaw daily by dozens of kids who were hoping to meet him. Additionally, this is something I only found out recently by dint of the Yiddish Book Center's use of OCR in the Yiddish books that they've scanned. But Wildman, this wrestler you see in front of you, he makes appearances in stories by Yud Lamed Peretz and Sholem Aleichem in, I believe, 1913, 1914, which really amazed me. And what it indicates is his popularity and also the idea that Peretz and Sholem Aleichem understood that this was a very popular figure on the Jewish street. Also, the Warsaw Press informed us that not only were wrestling matches incredibly popular among Jews, but in 1926, a Yiddish theater critic wrote an article complaining that more Jews were going to see wrestling matches than to all the Yiddish theaters combined. Moreover, as one intrepid reporter discovered, many of the Jewish wrestling fans happened to be Hasidic. Now, he initially was surprised by this phenomenon, and he was even more shocked to find out that when they went to see the Jewish wrestler fight, when that wrestler was in danger of getting beaten, the Hasidim in the crowd would stand up and begin singing psalms, which is really an amazing conflation of professional wrestling and Jewish tradition that I think most people really don't consider. Now, the Yiddish journalist who wrote about wrestling in Warsaw apparently really enjoyed reporting on the matches and clearly had a good time crafting the prose they wrote that was very much unique to Jewish involvement in the sport. Attempting to describe what a full Nelson was in the Warsaw Yiddish Press in 1925, and a full Nelson is a particular wrestling hold. Maybe Kalman can show it to someone after we're done. When a particular writer was trying to explain what a full Nelson was, he wrote, and I'm going to say this in Yiddish and I'll translate it afterwards. Die Sugje von Toppelt Nelson ist sehr schwere. Und kede des Teufels zu sein, darf man seine starke Muschlem in Dine Valkis. What this means is the subject of full Nelson is a very difficult one. And in order to grasp its meaning, one must be a powerful scholar of distinction in the laws of wrestling. So if you don't understand the Yiddish, what doesn't really come through in the translation is that the description is overloaded with high-end rabbinic verbiage and is clearly meant to be ironic. And in doing so, it's also very funny. Now, Yiddish journalists also compared, for example, the ease with which a particular wrestler placed his opponents in a full Nelson to a Kohen Duchening. A Kohen or a Kohen duchening is when they give the priestly blessing, they make this hand signal that most people associate with Spock from Star Trek. One of them stated that in literary circles, the full Nelson was jokingly known as the full Katznelson, which was a reference to the Yiddish writer Yitzchok Katznelson. Other press reports from Warsaw frequently likened Jewish wrestlers to Esau, Bar Kokhba, and Samson battling the Philistines, and the non-Jewish wrestlers they fought to Haman and Amalek and other enemies of the Jews. With these linguistic gymnastics, or linguistic gymnastics show is how Yiddish journalists and fans were able to Judaize wrestling reportage and make it authentically their own. Now, there was a fair amount of crossover in the Yiddish vocabulary used to describe what happened in the boxing or wrestling ring and the kind of violence that occurred in the streets. Ultimately, though, it was the streets that was of more interest to the scholars at YIVO, And when they solicited the article on Yiddish fighting words that I mentioned earlier from a young linguist by the name of Greenboim, their focus was on the language used in violent activity among Yiddish speaking Jews on the streets of Warsaw and Vilna. But what exactly prompted a sudden interest in Yiddish fighting words? It turned out to be a footnote from an article on a communal dispute that appeared in a Warsaw Yiddish newspaper in 1867 that someone had been researching for another reason. The article was written by a man whose name was Hertz Naimanovitz, and the footnote he appended to it reads as follows, and I'm quoting, "They say that the Yiddish language is not rich in words for fighting or words in which or words what which one uses to injure someone else. Patschen, gratschen, flasken, tramasken, bochen, zjochen, liapen, klappen, flicken, trennen. And if you ask me nicely, I'll provide over 30 words for fighting. New, what more do you want? Seems to me the Yiddish language has a wealth of such words." End quote. The implication, though, of Naimanovitz's reference to Jews and their relationship to fighting words was, first, a perception that Yiddish was a 97-pound weakling of a language and did not have a vocabulary sufficiently large enough to include very many words for violent activities, or as the writer says, for injuring people. The second implication, extrapolated from the first, was that no such vocabulary was necessary, since Jews themselves seemed to be too frightened to fight in the first place. Now, Max Weinreich, one of YIVO's founders and its then director, saw this footnote as an opportunity to begin collecting the vocabulary of violence that Yiddish had produced. Explaining the reasons for publishing a list of fighting words, Weinreich wrote the following in his short introduction to the list of nearly 100 words and phrases that they published. And Weinreich's intro reads as follows. "First of all, it's of no interest to us whether the idea regarding the richness of Yiddish was brought about earnestly or as a gag. What's important is that the number of fighting words, as Naimanovitz accurately points out, is a lot larger than 30. This is presented by us here and not, by the way, exhaustively in this collection presented by Greenboim. Here we have commonly used and occasionally used words and phrases. We're printing this work with the usual request to our readers. Send us even more material. It's especially necessary to document all the examples that appear in literature. In this collection, there are expressions with literary origins that may not have been noted." Now, a linguist whose main focus was Yiddish, Weinreich was more interested in documenting the language's vocabulary than studying the phenomenon of violence among Jews. The idea that something as seemingly exceptional as fighting words should exist in Yiddish was of no importance to him, because from his perspective, there, of course, there's a vocabulary for fighting in Yiddish. Jews are people and people fight. Ergo, there are phrases related to such activity in Yiddish. What Greenboim's research does show is that Yiddish is actually quite rich in describing the physical realm where Jews supposedly feared to tread. Lesser known, perhaps, among the Jewish intellectual classes, fighting words were the rhetorical domain of the undocumented and disdained subclasses of Yiddish speakers: blacksmiths, butchers, marketplace saleswomen, porters, wagon drivers, and others who worked with their hands and their bodies, street thugs who fought with each other and anyone else who dared cross them. Some channeled their fighting prowess into more organized frameworks and joined sports clubs. As mentioned, by the period of interwar Poland, professional wrestling and boxing had become very popular among Jews as both fans and athletes. Jewish boxers, wrestlers, and street fighters, however, are now mostly part of a bygone era. But it's important to note that they were once momentarily important figures in Jewish communities. They were heroes to the kids who tacked photos of their favorite boxers or wrestlers to their walls. That a distinct Yiddish lexicon exists to describe their exploits shouldn't be a surprise, but because of the ways in which history ravaged the Jews and the ways in which stereotypes about them developed, it somehow seems odd that Yiddish-speaking Jews engaged in violence in the same ways other people did. There will, of course, be people who will say, Jews didn't do those kinds of things. Unfortunately, those people are wrong. Jewish culture includes everything that Jews do, whether it's reading, fighting, playing hockey, or eating schmaltz herring. Looking at the language Jews used about fighting or anything else helps broaden our conception of the huge cultural universe of Yiddish-speaking Jewry that peaked before World War II. It also helps us understand the culture that they handed down to us and what we are able to do with it. Now, obviously, it would be terribly unfair if I didn't provide you with some examples of this vocabulary. So, you know, obviously, I'm going to show you some of these words. There will be translations, and you should feel free to use these terms and phrases as much as possible. Unterklätzl. This is a word that has a few synonyms, Putterplätzl and Benkele, and this is a powerful knee to the rear end. Reinfahren. This is as in Reinfahren in Piskarein, meaning to elbow or punch someone in the jaw. Reinstecken, as in Reinstecken der Harge, a powerful or literally a killer punch. A Barne is a close-fisted hit on the head with the knuckle of the middle finger raised, known in English as a noogie. This is probably called a Barne because a Barne in Yiddish is a pear, and this sort of vaguely resembles a pear. A Bintel finger, literally a bundle of fingers. This is a phrase for a punch in the mouth. You may or may not have heard of the Vorwärts famous Vorwärts newspaper's famous agony aunt advice column, a Bintel brief. This is the same sort of idea, but this is a Bintel finger, a bundle of fingers. A bench. This is literally a blessing, but it's to smash someone in the head with a piece of wood or some other item. A bencher, of course, as Sarah mentioned this phrase, this is a phrase that still exists in English, in Jewish English. And of course, if you go to a wedding or a bar mitzvah, sometimes you'll bring a bencher home, which would have been the piece of wood that you got hit with if it were a different context. Oops, sorry. Branzoletke, these are brass knuckles in Yiddish. Brocken is to break. Er hat ihm gut reingebrochen die Beindelach. He broke his bones real good. This last one on this page, der Gubernator, the governor. I wish I knew the etymology of this. It's quite interesting. This is to take one's thumb and jab it under a person's rib cage and into his side. Zboch, a quick punch with a closed fist. Zbang, a powerful punch with a fist or an object. Zetz. This is also one that has entered English, a quick, strong hit, or a tunk, an open-handed slap that gets inside the victim's mouth, literally a dunk. Now, one thing I want to mention about the first three of these, Zboch, Zbang, and Zetz, all of these have entered modern Hebrew as expressions for getting hit hard. So it's interesting that some of these have entered English. All of these have entered Hebrew, and there's also a well-known Israeli cartoon character whose name is Zbeng. Chsime, which is literally a signature, and in Yiddish you would say leg nechsime afen ponim, or you'd put your signature on someone's face by hitting it and leaving a mark. The second one is, I have to say, it's very unique. I've never heard anything like this in any other language. This is das Lempel, or the lamp. It's when you squeeze your victim's nose with the forefinger and thumb. I think it's called the lamp or das Lempel because when you squeeze someone's nose, it turns red. And this is the idea of the nose turns into a lamp. Now, when mucus is forced out of the nostrils, it's called the Lichtelech, or the little lights. This is obviously somewhat disgusting, but you know that's what YIVO has in the document. Last on this page is mashkante, to hold someone down and beat them, literally to take a mortgage out on them. Mashkante means mortgage. And interestingly, I've heard from contemporary Hasidim who told me that this word or this phrase is still in use today. Just something interesting to know. A flask or a frask is an open-handed slap across the cheek, hard enough to leave a red mark. A flick is a hard smack in the face. A klung is a punch in the teeth so hard the victim hears bells ring. And obviously, many of these are onomatopoeic, klung among them. A steisel is an uppercut which lands directly under the chin. Schmitz is to whip with a stick. And a schmier is an open-handed smack to the face. Sarah also mentioned this word in her talk, a schmier is in cream cheese on a bagel. This is somewhat of a different context. So that's what I'll leave you with today. I hope you enjoyed that. And I think we're gonna be ready for questions shortly.
Thank you so much, Eddy Portnoy, for opening up a window on not only a whole range of vocabulary, but also a whole range of behavior in the Jewish past. And I love the way these two talks dovetail together. I can hardly wait to work some of that vocabulary that you shared with us at the end into my conversations with people, but I think probably not into my practices. Well, maybe, we'll see. And if I do so, I will certainly credit you. We're going to actually use this moment to, I'm going to ask the people who have joined us to think of questions that you have for both Eddy Portnoy and Sarah Benor, who, in a moment, I'm going to turn over the mediator function to my colleague, Colin Weiser, and he will select, and he'll select from the questions that you enter in the Q&A. So thank you, Eddy Portnoy, and thank you also, Sarah Benor, and here's Colin Weiser.
Okay, here I am. First of all, I'd like to thank our speakers for their wonderful talks. Hopefully my children are not upstairs using some of the language right now that you've described, Eddy, because I heard a lot of screaming during your talk. I've known the speakers for 25 years now, I counted it. We all met when I was in graduate school with Eddy, and Sarah was an up-and-coming undergraduate who started the Yiddish Club at Columbia. There's so much I could say about this, but time is limited. I think to use the Jewish English term, I'm kvelling from both of you. Shkoyach, Hashem dank. Let's get to the questions. So a number of questions appeared in the Q&A during all this. So I'm going to start off with the first one for Sarah, but I think a lot of these questions actually overlap because they're both on linguistic topics and they both have to do with various unexpected aspects of the ways Jews talk and perceive themselves, or how the changes in how they talk and then perceive themselves. So the first question is, Sarah, could you elaborate on this interesting phenomenon of Jewish English parallels to it, or the same phenomenon happening in other contexts, particularly UK English, French, right? Yiddish influence on French, or the influence on Hebrew, which is something that Eddy talked about. Before you answer, I'll just say, you know, I'm sure you've thought about this already, but you really need to look around here in Canada and hear how the Canadian Jews use Yiddish words differently from the American Jews. And to add to this question, just before you get into it, someone asked me, what about Yiddish outside big, Yiddish English or Yiddish influence on English outside of big cities like New York? Could you elaborate on that?
Yeah, great questions, thanks. Well, I, in addition to my Jewish English lexicon, I also have worked with some colleagues to create parallel versions of that for other countries. So we have the Jewish Latin American Spanish lexicon, Jewish Russian lexicon, and Jewish French and Jewish Swedish. And I'm actually working on one right now for Jewish Portuguese in Brazil. And in most of these places, it's Hebrew and Yiddish words that are used in these places. But actually in France, in addition to the Ashkenazi communities, there is a much larger presence there of Jews from North Africa. And so there's a lot of Judeo-Arabic influence in French, in Jewish French. And also in Mexico City, there's a large Syrian Jewish community. And so there's a lot of influence from Syrian Judeo-Arabic there. And also from Ladino and from Yiddish, because there are the different Jewish communities in Mexico City and other parts of Latin America. In Venezuela, for example, there's a lot of Jacatia influence, which is North African Judeo-Spanish. And so what I'm talking about here in America, and I am talking about North America, not just the United States, there is a lot of influence from Yiddish because that was the majority of the immigration of Jews in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. And that had an impact on what on Jewish English. There are also influences from Ladino and from Judeo-Arabic in various Jewish communities in North America. For example, in Brooklyn, there's a Syrian Jewish community and they use a lot of words from Syrian Judeo-Arabic. Actually, someone is working on a dictionary of Syrian Jewish English as spoken in the United States. And in Seattle, there's a large Sephardic community from Rhodes and Turkey, and they, several generations after the main immigration, continue to speak English with influences from Ladino. And so actually these influences, some of them can be seen in my Jewish English lexicon. And you can, and if you read French and Spanish, you can see those other lexicons for those other languages. As for Canada, in Toronto, there's a really interesting pronunciation of the ah sound as uh. So I don't know if you've heard latke being latke or Shabbos being Shabbos. And it's interesting because this is not the kamatz sound. It's not in Hebrew words with the kamatz vowel, right? So I don't know why this developed in Toronto in particular. Perhaps there was more immigration from Bessarabia, from Totomomoloshin.
I have an answer, I think.
Okay. Just I want to hear your answer.
The influence of their Canadian English. Americans don't hear it as clearly as Canadians when they're speaking English, but we have a different vowel in Canada. I mean, I'm a native speaker of New York Jewish English, so I'm not a good representative of this. But certainly my children make this distinction. If we can spend more time talking about this, but that's just the influence of their English, I think.
Okay.
They mock the Americans for their Shabbos.
And then Americans make fun of the Canadians for their Shabbos. Yeah. Okay, that's helpful. And then also the question asked about the UK. So in my Jewish English lexicon, we have several words that are used in the UK and South Africa and Australia that are not used in the United States. One example is the word kitke, meaning challah, that is used in South Africa, but not in other English speaking countries, a Yiddish word. Also the word kugel in South Africa means essentially what a Jewish American princess is in the United States, in addition to the food itself. So there are some regional differences and there are some Yiddish words that became common in certain places and not others. And Eddy mentioned a bunch of them from modern Hebrew. There are a lot of Yiddish words used in modern Hebrew, despite the revernacularizers' best wishes. You know, they wanted to avoid Yiddish vocabulary in favor of Hebrew words. And for the most part they did, but there are so many Yiddish influences in pronunciation and in grammar and even some in vocabulary.
Okay, thank you so much. I have some questions now for Eddy. So firstly, I received a few people asking, do you know about Sami Luftschling? If you go into the JCC on Bloor Street in Toronto, you go downstairs into the gym, you'll see a big picture of this Jewish boxer from Toronto, Sami Luftschling. Have you heard about him? I wanted to tell you, by the way, Eddy, maybe you know this, that Schepfel Lothal settled in Montreal after the war.
Right.
Chapter about him. But now to the question. Someone's asking, two questions. One about the presence of vocabulary of violence in Shulam Aleichem and other writers, as well as in press reports about pogroms. To what extent is it there? And someone is asking about the image of Yiddish. Yiddish being perceived as a language of spite, the language of contempt. How does this all fit into Jews' self-perceptions of themselves at the time?
Well, first of all, I have never been in the gym of the JCC on Bloor Street. A comment I know you have. So I've never seen this this picture, but I've also I haven't heard of this particular boxer. But every city in North America that had a reasonably sized Jewish settlement had Jewish boxers. Whether it was Philadelphia or Boston or Detroit or Toronto, Montreal, boxing was incredibly popular among Jews in, from let's say the 20s to the 40s. And, earlier on, many, many Jewish boxers participated. And so it doesn't surprise me at all that, there's some very well-known boxer, Jewish boxer from Toronto, who's, still remembered today on the walls of the JCC. I might have thought it would, there would be more hockey players, but, that also exists. And, they also fight. So that's I won't really get into that. Now, as far as these phrases, whether in literature or in reports on pogroms and things like this, I did mention that, the sort of stereotype is that Jews are, were victims of violence much more than perpetrators. In a certain respect, that's probably true, but, sort of in the cities and the sort of low-level violence that I describe, or that at least the newspaper reports that I read describe, it's Jew on Jew violence. And there's really quite a lot of it. As far as, and that's where a lot of these terms appear. They also appear in reports on press reports in boxing, on boxing and on wrestling. Pogroms are described, you don't have phrases like this. The reportage is contextually different, and as a result, it takes a completely different tone. It's a somber and a tragic tone, and using phrases like these generally would be inappropriate, and so they don't do it. In Yiddish literature, like I said, you don't have a lot of physical fights. You have some slaps in the stories of Sholem Aleichem. You have low level stuff, but it's not it's not as serious as the things you'd hear on the street or in a boxing match. You wouldn't necessarily use those phrases. I will say that one phrase that the phrase that I've seen more than anything else is mashkante. The one that I put up is to take out a mortgage on someone. That appears quite a lot in press reports. This is to hold someone down and beat them. Apparently that, this is the pound and ground of Yiddish, press reportage and literature. That's generally where that appears. And as far as that, the Jews' perception of themselves, it's hard to say. When I read the press reports of Jews fighting in Warsaw or in New York, or even of journalists reporting on wrestling matches, it's more often than not frequently tinged with humor. Yiddish journalists, for whatever reason, love to hitch humor onto real human tragedy. And I can, if in my book, there are dozens of examples of humorously reported tragedies, whether, tragic violent activity, whether they're from, fights in the Warsaw Rabbinical Court or on the streets of New York, or on the streets of Warsaw. It's a very common phenomenon. So I can't really tell you how sort of Jews writ large perceived this kind of thing, but journalists thought it was hilarious and often wrote it as if it were funny. Now, one interesting thing is, in the wake of the Holocaust and, the distance of many years, I'll give lectures where I'll read you know, these or similar reports of Jews fighting, and sometimes people in the audiences will get offended and they'll say, you know, Jews didn't behave that way. The Jews did not do this. They couldn't have done this. And, you know, it's part of this, you know, on the one hand, as I mentioned, it's part of being middle class and not seeing how, you know, or sort of attributing your own behavioral mores to a previous generation that wasn't middle class. And also, you know, the real distance from a Jewish society that lived in really an utterly different way than we do today. And an unwillingness to accept that, you know, Jews can do not such great things.
Okay. I'm really sorry to say that we're actually out of time for today. That's a fantastic answer. And I have follow-up questions. I have 15 questions more to ask you guys.
I'll stay.
Thank you. I want to thank our guests, Sarah and Eddy, for these fantastic talks. This has been a wonderful opportunity for all of us to enrich ourselves, to learn more about contemporary Jewish English, contemporary English, and about the world of Yiddish culture and fighting Jews, of course. Wrestling has been a tradition in my family for four generations. We are big wrestling fans ever since the immigrant generation. I've passed it on to my daughters, I hope. This is fantastic. I want to remind everybody of our author's books. Eddie's book, Bad Rabbi. Sarah has a new book out, Hebrew Infusion. And of course, she also spoke about her earlier book about how Jews, as they're becoming more religious, begin to change the way they speak. So much to learn from them. And I want to say good night to all of our participants today and all of our, I don't know if you say listeners, viewers out there. Thank you all for joining us today. And I wish you all continued good health and a good rest of the week. Thank you very much. Good night.